Where does your financing come from now?
Right now I have no financing. The only financing we have are the Muslims who are still with me.
Well, how do you support yourself, Malcolm?
Well, I'm unsupported.
Well, you seem to be fairly well fed.
Well, fortunately, while I was among the Muslims, I never lived beyond my means, and I have learned how to live within means. And I still have the clothes that that was provided for me at that time. I'm in the house that was provided for me, although we're in a court battle. They're trying to get it back.
Within 5 months after this interview, Malcolm's house was bombed. And a week later, February 21st, 1965, Malcolm was assassinated in Manhattan's Audubon Ballroom. Three men were convicted of the terrible crime. This reporter interviewed the only one of those three who admitted to the assassination.
Were you offered any money to do this?
No, I wasn't offered any money for my partners. During the trial, I did state that. But that wasn't true. I was never offered any money, no.
Were you offered any assistance if you ran into any difficulty? Were there any assurances made for the protection of your family?
Well, I felt that the Muslims at the time would assist my family if my family needed some assistance.
Based on what?
Based on the fact that I was a Muslim at the time. And if I had got involved in something like this based on my beliefs and principles as being a member in the community at that time, that there would be some assistance in that respect.
That didn't happen?
Very little.
Where'd you get the weapons from?
The weapons, I picked the weapons up myself from an individual who had them, you know.
Weapons?
Weapons, yes.
How many did you pick up?
The ones that was used.
You picked up the shotgun?
Yes.
Were you the principal organizer of this?
No, I wasn't the principal organizer in respect to saying, well, the brain.
Who was the brain?
In that respect like that.
Huh?
Really was a collective effort and input into it.
But you were assigned to pick up the pieces?
Well, I knew I had knowledge where I could get things like that at that time.
Where'd you get them from?
I picked them up off an individual that I knew at that particular time.
In Newark?
That individual had no knowledge of what my intentions was.
Mm-hmm. Where'd you get the money to pick up these weapons?
Well, I had the money at that time.
How much did it cost you?
It didn't cost that much.
Give me an idea.
A few dollars here and there. Not that much at all.
50, 100, 75, 8 million?
What? No. Less than $100.
For a shotgun and two.
Well, this was really, I could get them. I could get them at, was no problem.
Tell me what weapons you did get, though. One shotgun.
Mm-hmm.
And?
The shotgun, the Luger, and the .45.
You got a Luger?
Yeah.
What weapon did you use?
I used the .45.
Where'd you learn how to use a .45?
Well, I don't know if I really was that learned at using it, but I think people on the street, you know, the average man on the street, I could use one just as well as the average guy, I guess. You know, I don't have any necessary expertise.
You had never fired one before?
Oh, I fired one.
Where?
I have gone hunting a few times.
With a .45?
Well, I've taken it with me. You know, it's not legal, but I've done it.
One doesn't normally think of hunting with a .45.
Well, you see, this is a situation where, no, you don't hunt with the .45. You carry the shotgun, the .45 under
right.
your coat. And when you get a chance to fire, you fire it every now and then. This sort of thing like this here.
All right, so you were practicing with it in the months leading up?
I have done this, not necessarily for this specific thing that I did, but I had done this.
Because one doesn't fire a .45 or practice unless they have something in mind and it's not hunting.
Well, Gil, I can disagree with you on that because
as
a kid growing up, I did a lot of things that was, you know, didn't have any real aim or purpose in it, but I did them anyway.
I see.
You know, this was really no thing that necessarily planned. This is out in the woods, and you couldn't fire a gun like that, let's say in city limits. You know, you would have to be out in the woods anyway. So when I would go hunting, I would take it with me sometime. This sort of thing like this. That's all. Nothing more or less than that.
Do you think that those who loved him had a greater obligation to offer him protection while he was alive? Do you think that we let him down?
I think that when people claim that they love a movement or they love a person or they love a thing and they only give lip profession to that, where they really don't come out and give the kind of support that's really necessary, when they really don't have the real kind of consciousness that it takes to protect and to help that thing to grow. See, when they don't have that, then they leave like a void for other things to get in. So what I'm simply saying is that because of the very thinking of the people, the government didn't care, you see. Others didn't care. So when this thing came about, it just made it that much more easier to happen. But if the people had responded to what was being said, what was being taught at the time, like they would have, I doubt if this would have happened.
In other words, you're saying that you could see from the previous rallies toward the end of his life that only a relatively small number of people were around him who cared about him.
I think so.
Or who were willing to protect him.
I think so.
And that's what made it possible for you to move in.
I'm saying that if the consciousness of the people had been greater, if the concern of the people had been greater, then I don't think that anything like this could have taken place like it did.
In retrospect, do you think that any government agencies had any role in allowing it to happen? You must have thought about the fact that all previous rallies, police were there. Many feel that plainclothes police were there when you pulled the trigger. Well, what are your feelings about that?
Actually, from what I understand, there was one plainclothes police there whom everyone knows about today. That was Gene Roberts, I think his name was. Yeah. Other than that, I couldn't say that that day that I actually knew that there was plainclothes officers on the set. I couldn't say that I actually knew that one way or the other. But from things that have been revealed from other investigations, I think it's a person's intelligence would automatically dictate to them that there probably was other officers on the scene at that particular time.
And still you'd go through with it?
I'm looking back at this from now. Then I wasn't thinking like that at that time.
Weren't there police outside when you entered the building?
Didn't you see police? I don't recall seeing any at that time.
If you had been casing the Audubon in the preceding weeks, you would have known, you would have seen police there, so it would naturally follow.
I understand that in the past the police was around. I don't actually recall seeing until I came out of the ballroom that day.
But wouldn't that have been a deterrent? I mean, the last time you cased the joint, as they say, police were there. You knew
the police. It would have been a deterrent if the officer was stationed in such a position that it could have affected the situation of entering. It would have been a deterrent if there was a search at the door. It could have been a deterrent in that respect. You know, entering the place would have been impossible under those circumstances. But none of this happened.
And so even
to my knowledge, I don't remember seeing an officer. He may have been there, but I just don't recall. I don't recall that.
Because those were very tense days, brother.
It's true.
And you knew that police were around there, whether you saw them or not. You must have known that.
Gil, I can walk into a bank if my intention is of sticking it up. I know that there's police somewhere. But if I don't know where they are, you know, what does it mean, you see? You can go in a place and come out. And there can be a different situation when you come out, so I couldn't say any more about
it. What were the forces, in your view, that wanted Malcolm dead?
There's no doubt, as we saw from that segment that you showed, that there were major members of the Nation of Islam who wanted him dead. There's also no doubt that the United States government wanted him dead. Now, people say, why do you say that? You know, whenever there's an investigation of a murder, the first thing they want to try to find out is who benefited. And if you look at it, the Nation of Islam did not benefit. They may have thought they were going to, but they did not benefit from the assassination of Malcolm X. In fact, it destroyed that organization for all practical purposes. They have never been the same since then.
What would the U.S. government have to gain?
The United States government was very afraid that Brother Malcolm, on an international level, he was planning on taking the U.S. before the world court for violating the human rights of African-American people. He was advocating a linking up of people of African descent in the Caribbean, Africa, in Europe, South America, and in the United States. All of this was at the beginning, but the fact that he was doing this, and especially in the context of the times, we're talking about the 1960s, the early 1960s, which was the height of the so-called Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union, and they were involved in a tremendous propaganda struggle with each other. So the fact that Brother Malcolm was taking the movement that was happening in this country, and putting it on an international level, was the same that England had to deal with, you know, when colonialism was put on an international level, or France. So the United States had always been able to kind of keep the racism against black people in this country within the confines of the United States. You know, nobody else could say anything about it. Brother Malcolm said, no, this is a part of the whole movement that's happening worldwide where people of color are trying to throw off the control of people of European descent. He was connecting us to that international movement. That was his goal. The OAAU had a foreign policy that was designed to connect the movement in this country to the international movement against European domination around the world.
I happen to be in here for killing a man who was a great leader of black people. And I happen to view this individual today in a different light to what I had viewed him before. In regard to the people who say that they love Malcolm, and I've heard the same thing with Dr. King and other great leaders, I think that the proof of that love really lies in the fact whether or not they're still upholding those principles that the man lived for, that he did give to the people, whether or not they are making that a part of their lives. I think that's the test of their love. I can't change that what has been done. I can only say that I am deeply sorry for my participation in this. And I know there'll be people who can never forgive me. But I pray, and in my prayers, and I pray five times a day, and I ask Almighty God, Allah, to forgive me. And if He forgives me, then this is the only time that I really can feel that I am forgiven. Because on that day of Yom Kiyama, which means the day of judgment, I have to answer for what I did. If I could change what I ever did, I would change. But we all know that I can't. So I'm hurt too. I'm deeply hurt too. And I feel deeply remorse in my participation in this. But I can't change anything.
Has it caused you personal anguish?
Sure it has. When you believe in something and you stand up for it in all these years, you feel that your participation is based on right action according to the way that you believe. And then you find that, hey, something else has gotten in there somehow, and that what you thought was not necessarily what was really happening, you see. So sure, I'm hurt. I sat in prison for a long, long time feeling that Malcolm was actually a man that was not a true leader of our people, that Malcolm was actually a man that was a hypocrite. When I come to realize that that was not true, then I've got to be hurt. I've got to be hurt.
I can only say this. In life, we do many things wrong. Sometimes it's not what you do, it's who you do it to. There's guys in prison for murders, rapes, robberies. There's some guys in prison for doing nothing. I know them personally myself. But I can't change that. I can't change that. You see?
What you've done is terrible because you took his life. What bothers me, I guess, is that I was not there to stop you. That's what bothers me.
Well, Gil, I guess I can understand your feelings.
And that I was so stupid, equally stupid, that I never even put myself in a position to offer him any help. And if more people had, it would have never entered your mind to make such an attempt.
I agree with that 100%.
And I guess all of those feelings come together. That's what bothers me so. So you're not the focus of my anger. You're part of it, though.
Well, you understand.
Yeah, I think I do. And I feel sorry for you and me, because we will have to live out the rest of our lives with our collective burden.
That's true.
Be happy now. Don't worry. Be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry. Be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry. Be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry. Be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry. Be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry. Be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry.